Welcome to Alaska Weather, a production of Alaska Public Media and the National Weather Service, Alaska Region. Produced and broadcast daily from the studios of KAKM, Alaska Weather provides complete forecasts, public, marine, and aviation for all of Alaska. Alaska Weather is made possible by the following sponsors.
The National Weather Service.
Good Tuesday, everyone. I'm meteorologist Dave Snider with the National Weather Service. It is the 13th of January. As always, we encourage you to stay up to date on your local weather information. You can do that in a variety of ways. Certainly calling the weather info line at 800-472-0391 may be your easiest way. But for many of you, finding us on the internet is also accessible there, and many pages are pretty quick to load. So try that if you haven't lately, even on your mobile carrier. arh.noaa.gov or weather.gov will get you there. Just click on Alaska. You can find us on Facebook in between shows on Alaska Weather. You can find us on Twitter, of course, and on YouTube. Around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, you'll get your daily afternoon map briefing. And following this show, you'll be able to get the complete weather forecast there. Alaska Weather brought to you by our broadcast partner here at APRN, or Alaska Public, I should say. You'll be able to get the complete broadcast there. If you want to go back and watch the Marines over and over and over, you can do that as many times as you like, and we'll have a new one for you again tomorrow. Here's a look at the hazardous weather outlook at this point. We're watching the middle Tanana Valley and the 40-mile country and the upper Tanana Valley for not only freezing rain, some light freezing rain possible through the middle Tanana Valley, especially north of Fox there. It looks like it'll be the biggest threat around the middle Tanana region. That'll go until about midnight tonight. Expecting very light amounts of freezing rain, but still the opportunity for freezing rain to occur, and thus making the travel a little bit tricky at times there. So just be careful there, especially north of Fox tonight. And then in the upper Tanana Valley and the 40-mile country, you could see about 3 to 5 inches of snow. A winter weather advisory is in effect for you. That'll last through the overnight hours there, so watch for that, and additional snowfall will be occurring there. Upwards into the upper Koyukuk Valley, also watching for wintry conditions. That is expected to continue as we head through the evening and overnight hours, and blowing and drifting snow may reduce visibility there. And then further north, the red shaded areas are wind chill advisory, or wind chill warnings, I should say. We're looking at wind chill values that could drop to 65 below, and those warnings will be in effect from 6 a.m. in the morning to 6 p.m. at night tomorrow. And again, with the stronger winds coming in from the east and northeast, we expect it to feel bitterly cold. And obviously any exposure for even a short amount of time could be very dangerous, if not deadly, to you. So be extremely careful there, especially if you get just a little bit in from the coast. So wind chill value is probably worse as you get away from the coastal areas. Looking a little bit further into the south and west, these are freezing rain advisories, not only for the Bethel communities and villages in the surrounding region, but also for the middle Kuskokwim Valley there, up toward Aniak and Sleetmute. Are expecting some lighter amounts of freezing rain. Right now, it does not look like it's going to be quite as bad as what you saw around Bethel just the other day, but it's going to be a little bit on the close side. So we're going to keep close watch on that and see if it starts to worsen as it progresses over the next several hours there and into tomorrow. But for right now, a freezing rain advisory is going into effect, and that'll start around 8 o'clock tonight until noon tomorrow. So we'll be watching carefully overnight and see if any changes happen in the latest weather models. But right now, we're looking at about a tenth of an inch of ice to about 2/10. The worst of it probably a little bit closer to Aniak and Sleetmute and into the more inland areas away from the Bethel community. So again, probably not quite as bad as what it looked like last week. Hopefully that's the way it looks at this point tonight. So here we go. Here's a satellite picture out across the Bering Sea, and something to look at as we go through the next series of satellite pictures and the weather charts. There are several waves of low pressure, all kind of rotating and pinwheeling around each other. This whole area here in the upper atmosphere is just keeping us chock full of weather disturbances. Each one of these has waves of low pressure wrapping around it. So every time you see one of these little swirls, you know, well, that's another storm that the folks at the Weather Service are watching very carefully to see how that affects our weather. Out across the Eastern Asia coastline, you don't see a whole lot of activity there. We've got a cold air dropping on the western side of the Kamchatka Peninsula, a lot of cold locked up across the Chukchi Sea that's traveling more to the north and east and bypassing Alaska So where are we? We're getting all the warmth from the Pacific, and all that is working its way slowly in from the east and southeast, coming up through southwestern Alaska, up towards St. Lawrence Island, kind of making it up to the Bering Strait, and then wrapping back around into the western Bering, the central and western chain, and then here it comes again, just spiraling back around again and again. As we look at the rest of the state, notice that we're on the eastern side, most of us anyway, are on the eastern side of that greater circulation. So where does that put us? Well, here comes another one of those waves working its way into the eastern Gulf of Alaska. This is going to bring a lot of rain to southeastern Alaska. It brought some wind today. Channeled areas, we're looking at wind gusts around 35 to about 50 miles per hour. We also saw some stronger gusts up around the Nulato Hills. And we'll continue to see some gusty winds around the Thompson Pass region. So as a result of that, we've got warm and wet air traveling northward. As the first boundary is already working its way inland tonight, winds will likely pick up across some of the higher terrain. And as we head into the overnight hours, we'll be watching for precipitation in many areas, especially around the Prince William Sound side and the Gulf Coast communities. Once we get into the interior, it is cold enough in some places for that to be snow, as we pointed out, around the 40-mile country and Northway up toward Eagle. North of Fox, though, it's still just warm enough that there's a risk of freezing rain. And again, that freezing rain advisory will stay in effect for a little while longer this evening. And across the west, you can see that low pressure system working in the east and southeasterly flow, taking that wave of low pressure and the actual circulation just west of St. Paul. There's areas of drizzle there and probably will continue there as we head into the overnight hours, maybe mixing in with a little bit of snow. Pretty much standard issue for you, but maybe a little bit on the warm side for the western coast for sure, and certainly in south central Alaska. Here's the way it looks around the weather map, stationary boundary just north of the Alaska Range, and places like Eagle today, we're seeing moderate to occasionally heavy snow, it looked like. Occlusion just across the Gulf Coast there, working its way north of Kodiak Island, attached to low pressure at 977 millibars. Frontal boundary working into southeastern Alaska there, and you can see rain was already working its way into southeast. Another surge of wetter air is working its way northward into the central and eastern Gulf of Alaska as we went through the afternoon. There's the drizzle out in the Pribilofs and a little bit of light rain out around Shimya and Attu, and you can just barely see them. If you've got a smaller TV screen, you might be able to miss it, but I'm going to point out right about here is a 959 millibar low, and a little bit further out to the west is a 969 millibar low. Here's one circulation, another circulation, two more on the Pacific side, and one more in the Bering. All of this, again, just wrapping in on itself. Where's high pressure? Way up north around the Chukchi Sea. That ridge extends way out toward KwX, a little bit of fog there today, but the brunt of the cold air is moving its way east and dropping its way southeast into the interior of Canada, totally bypassing Alaska. One exception, though, if you're on the Arctic coast, you know it was cold today. Temperatures there anywhere from 25 to 30 below, not counting any wind chill. So you are getting just a little taste of it, but that's about where it stops. As we head into tonight, low pressure across the central Gulf at 972 millibars, still pushing that front further and further into the south central locations, Kodiak Island, and it will gradually move it over the Alaska Peninsula and kind of expand and fall apart, replaced by another wave coming in from the south. Meanwhile, winds will probably pick up around southeast. Rain continues for you tonight. Inland areas, probably looking at just scant amounts of freezing rain. Not expecting to see a whole lot around south central Alaska. The greater threats from this will be around the lower Kuskokwim Valley out toward Bethel, again with freezing rain advisories picking up from 8 o'clock tonight and lasting until noon tomorrow. Periods of light freezing rain may continue around the middle Tanana Valley as we head through tonight, as I mentioned, and areas of snow for some of the eastern, more interior regions. By Wednesday, that starts to become more showery in nature and gradually comes apart. Areas of blowing and drifting snow may be possible a little bit closer to the Alcan border and also around the Chukchi Sea coast. For the lower Kuskokwim Valley, again, we're still watching for freezing rain. Most of that, again, still appears light at this point, but watch for updates there. Right now, it is just an advisory. If it gets worse, it could become an ice storm warning. And if the threat goes away, we'll let you know that as well. Areas around light rain, around Kodiak and the Alaska Peninsula should see some light rain. And we've got a 966 millibar low just southwest of Kodiak and another one south of Dutch Harbor on Alaska at 964 millibars. But there's still more out to the west, and another wave will be working its way just west of Yakutat, bringing the frontal boundary right up to coastal southeast. Snow showers continue for the Copper River Basin and the northern parts of the Yukon, Kuskokwim Delta region. And blowing and drifting snow still possible for the Chukchi Sea coast. Watch for that to continue as we head into Thursday. Stronger winds will be wrapping their way down through the Bering Strait. The ice, really not very stable, it looks like. A lot of ice is on the move at this point, so shore fast ice I wouldn't just give it one glance, give it several glances, and maybe just stay off of it at this point. With some of the winds there and the recent temperatures that we've seen, our sea ice desk forecaster saying a lot of the shore fast is not that fast at this point. Low pressure across the Bering Bristol Bay region at 963 millibars. Now in control of our weather picture by Thursday. You can see the front stretching all the way up through southeast, crossing the Kenai Peninsula, crossing the Yukon-Kuskokwim Delta and the central and eastern Aleutians. This is going to be falling apart pretty quickly on Thursday, but it's still bringing southwesterly winds into southeastern Alaska with rain there, rain mixed with snow around Prince William Sound. Probably looking at a pretty dry period there around the Anchorage Bowl up through the Matsu Valley and the Susitna Valley, especially west of the Parks Highway. Probably looking at a partly cloudy sky around places like Talkeetna and Willow by Thursday afternoon, thanks to that southeasterly flow coming up over the hills. The front will start to fall apart across the Yukon-Kuskokwim Delta by Thursday afternoon. On the north side of that, there still could be some snow around St. Matthew and south of St. Lawrence Island. And anything we see in the interior at this point looks to be showery in nature, so probably not a huge threat for greater accumulations. And generally, northerly flow coming across the central and western chain and unsettled and wet for most of the Alaska Peninsula and Kodiak Island. Temps today in the lower to mid-40s for southeast. It was windy, but it was fairly mild, and rain was passing through from time to time. Some places around Yakutat picked up more than 1.3 inches of snow today. Many in southeast were looking at about a half inch to at least an inch where it was raining, most notably. Places like Juneau picked up about a half inch, and that was about 6/10, so pretty soggy weather there. Prince William Sound in the upper 30s to lower 40s, 40 around Anchorage, 46 in Homer today. For the interior, we saw temps in the lower to mid-20s, and once you got north of the Yukon, that's when you started to get into what you would probably expect to be seasonable cold, at least a taste of it. 4 below in Yukon and Fort Yukon, 6 below in Anaktuvuk Pass, Arctic Village, 17 below, and then the Arctic coast, anywhere from 15 to as cold as 25, even 26 below, up around Kuparuk and Prudhoe Bay and Dead Horse. Kaktovik was 24 below. Kotzebue Sound saw temperatures there in the lower to mid-teens, 28 in Nome. Norton Sound temperatures in the mid to upper 20s. Galena was looking at 11, McGrath 22, Bethel 29 degrees. Southwest into Bristol Bay, 30s and 40s there for King Salmon and Dillingham. Kodiak Island in the lower 40s, about the same for all of the Alaska Peninsula. 42 in Dutch Harbor and Alaska, just shy of 40 in St. Paul today, and upper 30s for the central and western chain. Overnight low temperatures will be just as cold as they are right now for the Arctic coast, looking at anywhere from 15 to 30 below. The middle Tanana Valley and most of the interior looking at single digits to low to mid-teens. South central upper 20s to low 30s. Southeast upper 30s and lower 40s, 39 in Kodiak. Close to 40 and just below there in the Alaska Peninsula. Upper 30s for the Pribilofs and mid-30s for the central and western chain with highs nearing 40 there tomorrow. And similar conditions for the Alaska Peninsula. Lower 40s for Kodiak and mid-40s, maybe even upper 40s, pushing 50 degrees, in fact, for Annette and Ketchikan. Hyder closing in on 50 degrees. The Arctic coast may be a little bit milder, if you can say that, with temps well below zero, 10 to as cold as 20 below. 13 above for Fairbanks, mid-20s there for Denali and Healy, and you're looking at mid to upper 30s for most of south central and southwestern Alaska with Nome at 26. Flying weather now, you can see a broad area of IFR along the frontal boundary stretching across the northern Gulf Coast, but you don't see a lot of that moisture impacting things by tomorrow afternoon inland, so conditions will be improving from what we see in the morning. Out across the west, expect IFR conditions around coastal areas of the YK and generally south of St. Lawrence Island to Nunavak Island and along some hit and miss places for the Alaska Peninsula and Eastern Chain. Anaktuvuk Pass, we expect to be VFR by the end of the day. Same goes for Adigan Pass. Lake Clark and Merrill Pass will start at IFR. Watch for gradual improvements there throughout the day and for Rainy Pass. Windy Pass, we expect to see improvements throughout the day starting out, though, around MBFR. Similar conditions should be expected around Isabel Pass. Mentasta Pass may maintain VFR throughout a good chunk of the day. Tanita Pass, MBFR to start anyway. Porter's Pass, we expect to see IFR with rain in the region, maybe mixed with snow, and then transitioning toward improving weather. The western side might be VFR for a good chunk of the day. And Chilkoot and White Pass, we expect to see marginal conditions through most of the day. Freezing levels show that warmer air moving northward, but the warmer air aloft is beating it well northward into the northern tip of the Seward Peninsula, in fact, 2,000 feet. And you can see a tight gradient across southeast with levels as high as 8,000 feet and levels as high as 4,000 feet over Kodiak Island and parts of the Alaska Peninsula. icing potential then, with a lot of moisture here, you have to go up to about 6,000 to 8,000 feet to find any decent chance for light to isolated moderate icing. Some of that, though, starts to pick up a little bit more around the Copper River Basin and points east into northern sections of southeast. Southern parts of southeast generally above 10,000 feet. And around Norton Sound in the lower to mid Yukon Valley, you're talking about occasional moderate above 6,000 feet. And for some areas in the central and western chain, above 4,000 feet. The jet stream shows a really broad area of high pressure stretching all the way into eastern Asia. With that, though, we have a very fast Pacific jet zipping around 145 to 190 knots that eventually ends up in the Pacific Northwest. All of that is shunting a lot of the weather well south of Alaska and keeping us fairly mild. At 9,000 feet, the southerly flow working up over the Gulf really puts on the brakes as it moves over the interior, with wind speeds there around 5 to 15 knots. You can see several circulations again out across the southern bearing in the North Pacific, some of the stronger winds over the central Gulf, and also working their way over southeast from 50 to 60 knots. But at 3,000 feet, they really slow down as they move over that higher terrain. You're looking at winds coming in right along the coast from about 25 to 50 knots or so, moving over the interior around 20 knots, stronger winds from the east across the Arctic coast there. And you're looking at an offshore flow for the YK around 15 to as high as 40 knots. And again, several circulations there in the southern Bering Sea. So turbulence potential, absolutely over southeastern Alaska, over south central, Kodiak, southwest, and a large part of the central and eastern chain all the way up the Alaska Peninsula, generally below 6,000 to 8,000 feet. And that could be as high as occasional moderate, maybe even widespread moderate. A lot of folks reporting today with PIREPS today, and we certainly appreciate that, as do your fellow aviators. Out across the west, you'll notice some occasional moderate there around the Chukchi Seacoast and north of the Bering Strait. Most of that will also maintain below 4,000 feet. So fly safely tomorrow, fly carefully, and we'll be back with your marine weather here in just a few minutes.
Her name is Patty Wagstaff, one of the most celebrated aerobatic pilots of all time. Three-time U.S. National Aerobatic Champion, she is the first woman to win this title. Because of her achievements, Patty has been honored by the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum as a pioneer of flight, and her Goodrich Extra 260 aircraft occupies the same gallery at the Smithsonian as Amelia Earhart's Lockheed Vega.
I have to admit, what I do seems like a pretty dangerous way to make a living. I suppose that's part of the appeal, why so many people come out to see me fly and to see me take these risks. But as fellow pilots, I'll let you in on a little secret. There's risk, all right. As you know, anytime you climb into an aircraft, there's risk. But over the years, I've learned to minimize that risk by careful preparation, training, planning, common sense, and constant situational awareness. Attention to safety keeps me alive in the air. But safety doesn't begin at the top of an inverted loop. Safety begins on the ground, before you get in your airplane.
As pilots, most of us have seen a great deal of change in airport operations over the past few years. Today, there are nearly 70 million tower operations annually, and the number is growing each year. Pilots are challenged with more and more complex air traffic procedures, more complicated airport layout design. More and more, it is an environment of very real risk. But just as Patty Wagstaff has developed strategies for mitigating risk in the air, pilots can do the same on the ground by following standard procedures, such as using airport diagrams and planning their taxi routes.
The great majority of runway incursions are caused by pilot error. And the great majority of those errors, more than 70%, are caused by general aviation pilots. Those of us who have been flying for a while remember that they didn't teach us much about runway safety back in the days when we were in training. In recent years, that's changed. The FAA has developed a number of educational programs and strategies to help pilots improve runway safety. In fact, with more than 650,000 pilots and more than 240,000 aircraft all conducting millions of operations around the clock, it's amazing how safe our airports are. But still, with the best of training, collisions can happen at any airport, at any time, to any pilot. We may be good pilots, but we are also human. And sometimes we make very human mistakes.
And ground Cessna 9301. Say again.
Runway incursions are most often the result of a loss of situational awareness. For a variety of reasons, the pilot becomes confused by the airport's signs and layout, or doesn't listen to or understand the controller's instructions, or simply fails to follow instructions.
Cessna 3 Sierra Papa.
Hold short, runway 26 left.
453 Sierra Papa, hold short, runway 26 left.
Cessna 3 Sierra Papa, you're over the whole line.
Often this is because he or she is unfamiliar with the airport. The pilot's fatigued or is distracted by something in the cockpit.
You know what I was doing last night?
For a few critical seconds, pilots lose track of where they are in relation to their surroundings.
You can imagine how important it is for me to focus on situational awareness. In the air, my life depends on it. If I don't know precisely where I am and where I'm going, and the tasks required to get me there, the consequences could be catastrophic. And the same goes for you, and for me, on the ground.
One of the first keys to situational awareness is attention to detail even before you start your engine. Just as we always study area charts and weather information before we fly, it's important to be thoroughly familiar with the airport's layout before we taxi. Every airport is different, so it's important to obtain and study airport diagrams. Pay particular attention to complex or confusing runway and taxiway intersections and runway thresholds. Some airports publish hotspots on their airport diagrams. For example, intersections, where pilots should be especially vigilant. Obviously, we should make a similar study of the airport at our destination. Once you are thoroughly familiar with the airport layout, make sure you review the signs you will encounter as you taxi toward the active runway. Some simple phrases can help you remember what the signs mean. Black square, you're there. These black signs tell you which runway or taxiway you're on right now. Yellow array points the way. These yellow signs with black arrows point you toward a runway or a taxiway, or toward a destination, such as a ramp. If you see white numerals on a red sign, remember, red and white, runway's in sight. This type of sign shows the hold position for the runway. Remember, yellow markings represent taxiways, and white markings represent runways.
And remember, the big jet always wins, so watch out there. Here's a look at southeast, and the winds tomorrow will be picking up throughout the day, especially across the coast. Looking for winds there, especially around the Dixon entrance and northward, coming up to decent gales anyway. 40 knots, 17 to 19 foot seas there. In the inner channels area, looking at 30 knots. Around Ketchikan and Metlakatla, 6 foot seas possible in the Clarence Strait. And notice the winds continue to pick up as we go into Thursday, especially further north, coming up to storm force there, approaching that at least with some gusts, west of Gustavus up toward Yakutat, about 45 knots there, so at least decent gales. 40 knots coming in from the south and west, south of Sitka. And northerlies continue to work their way southward into the Stevens Passage region, about 20 knots, 4 foot seas there coming out of the Lynn Canal, and 8 foot seas across the Clarence Strait. Looking at 40 knots there, still from the south and east on Thursday. For south central, a broad northeasterly flow working across Prince William Sound, the north and western Gulf. You'll see storm force winds on either side of the Barrens, looking at 14 to 19 foot seas there. Those 19 foot seas extend into the eastern side of Kodiak Island. And Shelikof Strait winds are coming up to the 45 knots or so with the northeasterly flow. And you'll see those northeasterlies all the way up Cook Inlet in ice-free waters that could be as high as 5 foot seas in the northern Cook Inlet. And northerlies coming into the Cook Inlet, they're starting out at 20 knots, picking up to 30 knots, but diminishing from what we see tomorrow. Easterlies coming across Prince William Sound at 25 knots, the strongest winds in the Gulf, in the northern end anyway, up to 40 knots, with 18-foot seas there out of side of the Hitchinbrook entrance, and easterlies in Chelikoff Strait now, coming down to about 25 knots with 6 foot seas by Thursday afternoon. For southwest Alaska, northeasterlies inside of Bristol Bay at 30 knots with a 7 foot sea, 13 to 15 foot seas there on the Pacific side, coming in around 35 knots from the east and northeast. And you'll see a little bit of a change in direction during the day on Thursday. Northeasterlies still on the Bering side, but southeasterlies developing around Castle Cape to Chignik, and then northerlies coming off of Perryville, Sandpoint, and King Cove around 25 knots with a 12 foot sea. Across the Aleutians, east and northeasterly winds continue around 25 to 30 knots in most areas, a little bit higher there south of Nikolsky and on Alaska. Northwesterlies from Kiska to Attu at 15 to 20 knots. By Thursday, a broad northerly flow there as that trough of low pressure drops a little bit further south. You'll look at 9 to 10 foot seas there across most of the Bering Sea coast, and 9 to 10 foot seas also along the Pacific coast. 20 to 25 knots are expected. For the west coast, freezing spray around any area that's still looking at some open water. Otherwise, east and northeasterly winds around 20 to 30 knots with 7 to 11 foot seas, the highest around St. Matthew, and northeasterlies coming out of the Kuskokwim Delta to the Pribilofs, 5 to 6 foot seas there with 20 to 25 knots. By Thursday, we're back into the northerly flow in most areas with winds as high as 40 knots around the St. Lawrence Island seacoast. 10 foot seas are expected there, and 14 foot seas around St. Matthew. Around the Arctic coast, broad easterly winds still sweeping across the Northland there, with northeasterly winds from Cape Lisburn down into the Kotzebue Sound region, 20 to 30 knots. Blowing and drifting snow may reduce visibility, especially along the Chukchi Sea coast, and winds will stay up around 25 to 30 knots in most areas through Thursday as well. Recapping tonight's weather, for most of the middle Tananaw Valley, especially north of Fox, you'll be watching for a mixture of light snow and maybe some light freezing rain. The greatest threat of freezing rain seems to be north of Fox tonight. Your freezing rain advisory should expire in the next little while. For the 40-mile country in the upper Tananaw Valley, you're looking at a winter weather advisory for a total of 3 to 5 inches of snow. That'll continue through the evening as well. Rain spreading in through southeast. We're watching a freezing rain advisory that'll start around the lower Kuskokwim and middle Kuskokwim Valley around 8 o'clock tonight. Expecting about a tenth of an inch or so to maybe 2/10 in the upper Kuskokwim. Should not be quite as bad as what you saw earlier, I think it was last week, where you picked up about a quarter inch in Bethel, so probably not that bad. Periods of rain and snow across south central, and snow showers in the interior with a wind chill warning for the northwest. Wind chill values to 65 below. Stay warm.
These forecasts are to be used for planning purposes only. Call 1-800-WX-BRIEF for a formal pre-flight briefing. Always file a flight plan before you go flying. The U.S. Coast Guard Auxiliary urges you to leave a float plan with a friend or the harbor master before you go boating. Alaska Weather is made possible by the following sponsors.
The National Weather Service.